This week, silver surprised the markets, adding 1.5% on the heels of the first Fed rate hike in a decade. Well, Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, and holidays, everyone. It's just a pleasure to be back with you. Your host, Chris Waltzek, with one of the last shows of the year, our 10th. Well, they finally did it. Dr. Yellen did the unthinkable, removed the liquidity punch bowl from the digital Wall Street trading floor, and the stock market threw a tantrum. We'll discuss just what this could mean to the precious metals and related markets in our market weather report. Next at bat, Dr. Lawrence Kotlikoff, author of the INFORM Act, signed by 17 Nobel laureates, joins me. His latest New York Times bestseller, Get What's Yours, The Secrets to Maxing Out Your Social Security, outlines must-know tips on how laws have changed. And even if you're not quite at retirement age, you could still benefit significantly with disability and spousal disability and so many other changes. They really outline it here. I think a must-hear report. Be sure to listen closely as he outlines the steps to increase monthly benefits by thousands, even more, each year. Then an encore episode with David Morgan. He proposes a bimetallic standard, and we both agree that silver deserves to return as a major monetary metal and even a competing currency. And then Robert Ian wraps up the show with his latest must-hear report. We'd like for you to call into our toll-free hotline, 1-206-6665-370. Just jot it down, if you would, please, on a Post-it pad, or program it right into your phone or iPhone. GoldSeek begins now with the market weather recap. Mostly sunny skies hovered over the New York COMEX exchange as investors turned to gold and silver on dollar weakness with the big rate hike announcement. Gold gave back only 9, finishing near the break-even point at $10.65 an ounce. Silver added 21 cents, up 1.5% for the week, finishing at $14.15. The XAU Gold and Silver Equities Index fell 2.9 points at 44.54, and West Texas Intermediate Crude actually gained 70 cents, 2% at $36 a barrel. Well, the top story this week should require little introduction. It was anticipated on the show for many months. The Federal Reserve finally raised rates a quarter point, first time in a decade. The FOMC meeting statement right here shows tame inflation and unemployment figures. Of course, now the Fed governors aren't exactly looking for work up in their ivory tower. From down here on the streets, it's a little easier to see the millions of job seekers. Even the dollar struggled this week amid as officials at the Bank of Japan followed the Fed's footsteps, weakening monetary policy. Bottom line on Wall Street. Well, now that rates are at a half a point, finally, odds strongly indicate no further hike at the next meeting in January, about 91% odds of holding pat. This could provide a window of opportunity with the holiday buying season for metals to surprise the short sellers. Moving on to the Wall Street report, clouds reappeared over the New York Stock Exchange as investors were disappointed by an end to the nearly 10 years of free money. The rate hike increases the cost of borrowing for corporations. As new projects become more expensive, so does buying back company shares. This reduces overall demand for stocks. The net result could be sharply higher volatility as financial institutions and corporations adjust their rate expectations. The Dow finished at 17,265, off 137 points, less than 1% for the week. While the S&P 500 was off fractionally, ending at just above 2,000, and the NASDAQ fell 10 points, finishing at 49.23. Well, one of the most impressive bull markets in decades might be coming to an end as the Fed and BOJ both put the brakes on their monetary policies. Plus, the collapse in crude oil prices has investors questioning if the U.S. economic recovery is still at full steam amid an increase in oil rig count, suggesting the pipeline is now full supply, low demand, and perhaps lower prices. And then lower energy prices tends to weigh heavily on the S&P 500 components, putting further downward pressure on the indexes. Bottom line on Wall Street. Well, our seven-component sentiment index remains in the fearful zone, but nowhere near panic levels yet, which indicates there's plenty of room on the downside. In addition, the CBOT, VIX, and VVIX indexes are showing real signs of life, suggesting a repeat of the late summer sell-off could be a real possibility. Caution is advisable here for short-term investors. Coming up after the break, more GoldSeek.com radio with David Morgan and Professor Lawrence Kotlikoff. We'd like for you to stay with us right here. Up next, Professor Lawrence Kotlikoff, economist at Boston University and author of the INFORM Act. The Social Security law has changed. Key secrets may require action before April 30th, 2016. If you or your spouse turns 66 by then, you need my featured guest's new New York Times bestseller, Dr. Lawrence Kotlikoff. Welcome back to the show, sir.
Great pleasure to be with you.
Get What's Yours. It's received a very warm welcome. I'd like to share just a few comments from, you know, some of the Cognoscente, an indispensable, surprisingly entertaining guide to Social Security from a former news anchor, a great book, and it's entertaining too. The professor grasps the intricacies of this complex system. Care to tell listeners what led you and your co-authors to pen this bestseller, please?
Well, we realized that people had essentially no clue and that they were getting terrible advice, if you can call it that, Social Security offices. What's going on there is just a disgrace. Most of the people there are undertrained, overwhelmed. I changed my 96-year-old mom's Social Security address today. You know, they don't know the system very well. And so there are people leaving tens of thousands of dollars on the table by following what they think is the right thing to do, and they go to the Social Security office and they're told stuff that's not right, and then they're induced to take their benefits early. I think I wouldn't be surprised if the workers there think that they're going to get a bigger bonus at the end of the year, just have a higher chance of keeping their job the more benefit requests they file, and they're filing people far too early because you have 80% of households are taking, of workers are taking their retirement benefits before retirement age. Only 2% are taking them at 70, even though their benefits start at a 76% higher value adjusted for inflation than they do at 62. So the entire collection process is an abject failure. That whole decision making is just at one quick glance at the numbers, you can see that they have screwed up for millions of Americans, pushing them into taking benefits early. And the logic that they've been using is they're saying, well, look, it doesn't matter when you take it. It's a break even. Take it now, because if you don't take it now, you could die and die before you get anything. And that is backwards, because if you die, you're going to be in heaven and not need money. If you when you live to 100, that you are going to be kicking yourself every month when you're opening up a check not 6% higher than the check you're opening because you took your benefits at 62. So part of the book that we wrote, Get What's Yours, became a New York Times national bestseller for 6 months. It was New York Times number one bestseller for a week or two. It got, I think, a lot of interest because we explained how to think about longevity risk, and that Social Security is really an insurance mechanism, and that the real risk is not dying. The real risk, financially speaking, is living. So part of it was that. Part of it was dealing with the complexity and explaining for different types of people what they should do. And part of it was helping people understand that they have to tell Social Security what to do, not ask them when they go into the office. They can't rely on them to get anything except the wrong answer. That's the only thing you can really rely on when it comes to Social Security, because people are trying other, you know, the people that come in the office, they're all primarily well-meaning, but they seem to think for sure they know the answers. I had one lady, just to give you an example, who went to the Tacoma, Washington office after having called Social Security five times on the phone, spoke to five different people. She was 63 when she took her retirement benefit. She was 66 at the time she interacted with me, which was last spring. And she wanted to suspend her retirement benefit and start it up again at 70 at a 32% higher number value, which is her perfect legal right. And five times on the phone when she was told she wasn't allowed to do this. Then she goes to the Tacoma office and is told by somebody who's been on the job for 6 months she's not allowed to do it. Then she says, well, I just read this in the book. Could you please get your supervisor come? Well, the supervisor comes over. It's a Mrs. Brown. She says, absolutely, you're not allowed to do this. And so now we've got seven people that have told her the wrong thing. And then, fortunately, the lady Mrs. Brown's telephone number. Friday night, one Friday night after this happened, after she met Mrs. Brown the same day, I left a message on Mrs. Brown's telephone. I said, Mrs. Brown, could you please call me over the weekend, or otherwise you're going to be very famous in PBS NewsHour's column that I write every Monday. I'm going to describe this misinformation that you just provided to this lady. We'll just let everybody understand how job you're doing. And Mrs. Brown, to her credit, took my still seemed to be unsure about what to do, but she told her boss, the head of the office at Tacoma, Washington, to call me. So Saturday morning, I got a call. He's in there working on Saturday, to his credit. He says, I've been working at Social Security for 30 years. I've never heard of this. Well, you know, I've been writing about this and every other financial columnist. I'm not a financial columnist as a main profession, but I do write financial columns. I write a lot about Social Security. People have been writing about this for years. Okay. And it's not a mystery that you can suspend your benefits, start up again. Anyway, the head of the office doesn't know about this. He tells me after working there for 30 years, this is the eighth person who seems to not understand the basics, one of the most basic features of Social Security. Anyway, he says, hold on. I'm going to check on this. I'll get back to you. 2 hours later, he calls me back. He's absolutely right. We're going to have the lady in on Monday and fix this up. You know, it's really not a knock on these people. They tried their best, but they were quite sure and adamant that without going off and doing research for this lady, that they had things right. And they had things 100% wrong, including all the folks they talked to on the phone. So you have to know what to tell Social Security to do. And you have to say, here's what I want to do. And you got to go in the office and have them sign a piece of paper saying that they received exactly what you asked them to do, because they can go and turn around and do the wrong thing for you or to you. And you'll have no way of documenting that these are the reasons that I wrote the book. It wasn't, I didn't think the book was going to be successful particularly. I'd written 16 books, and none of them were bestsellers. But the combination of myself and Paul Solomon, who's a PBS NewsHour economics correspondent, and Phil Mueller, who's a personal finance columnist of long standing, I think the three voices blended together, and we tried to keep it funny and also angry. I think it's a disgrace to the public. So there's a certain amount of anger in this book about how people are being treated by the basic savings system of our country that nobody can understand. So these things showed up in the book and made it pretty successful.
I'd like to do a quick recapitulation here of everything you've just thrown out there, because you and Mr. Mueller and Solomon, I think, quite a service for people. I mean, look, when the head of that department, or who knows how far up the ladder, doesn't even know you can suspend and reactivate your Social Security benefits, how many tens of thousands of other people out there? These are folks who are at a point in life where they've paid into the system, they need the help the most, and they're starving for the right information.
Thank you. And I just want to mention one other thing, which is that on the side, I have a software company, and we have a program called MaximizeMySocialSecurity.com, MaximizeMySocialSecurity.com. It's a $40 program. And in addition to reading the book and reading columns I've written about the new law, which was passed in November, which is posted at that website, MaximizeMySocialSecurity.com, having that background and then also running our program, and it's very easy. It looks like TurboTax the way it's laid out. You'll know exactly what to do when you go to the Social Security office and say, here's exactly what I want to do. I'm going to follow these instructions. Please sign that you received this and write, I received this, on the printout of the PDF that says what to do at what time. This is exactly what I want to do. I want you to sign and confirm. I want to do exactly this and nothing else. Because, you know, people, for example, try to wait till 70. They go in about 3 months early to take their age 70 retirement benefit, just to sign up and say, I'd like to get my benefits starting at 70. And then they find out that somebody decided that they should give them 6 months of retroactive benefits. So they push them back 9 months from age 70. They lose 9 months of retirement credits. Their benefit is basically 6% lower for the rest of their life because somebody decided to take on them, some staffer decided that they were going to help this person by giving them retroactive benefits, which is exactly the opposite of what they wanted. That's the kind of thing that's happening all the time. Not exactly that one, but things like that happening are happening because unless you have it in black and white. This happened to my dentist. You know, I talked to him. He's 72. He told me that he'd wait until 70 to collect his retirement benefit. He said, you know what, I went in 3 months early, and then they gave me a retroactive check for 6 months, and you didn't even know it. And this is a top dentist at the Mass General Hospital.
There's pearls of wisdom here for virtually everyone. And what I mean is, whether you're single, married, widowed, with or without dependents, no matter your status, no matter the category that they're going to toss you into.
Well, I want to really caution the listeners here that the book was exactly accurate before they changed the law on November 1st. And now, if you're going to read the book, you also have to read my columns that are at MaximizeMySocialSecurity.com that were published after November 1st, where I talk about the new law and what it means, because some of the strategies we laid out in the book are no longer legitimate or valid for people under certain ages, for younger people. And some people were grandfathered under the old law. So it's a combination of these two things. We are going to have a revised version of the book out in May that we're working on right now. But first, completely up to date, it deals with all the new provisions. It deals with disabled people and the children's benefits and spouse and benefits. So when you asked, is there something that some people can, some married couples can get spouse benefits? There's some couples right now who can't get spouse benefit for one of the two of them, but get divorced, they can get two spousal benefits, maybe increase their lifetime income by $100,000 and live together just as if they were married, and when they're 70, get remarried. From what I understand, I think that's perfectly legal. There's whoever wrote this change in the law did it in 5 minutes in the dead of night and with no public hearings, the most undemocratic thing you could think of. And then it was all handed to Congress as a fait accompli, vote on this in the next 2 days. You can read about the Obamacare bill after you voted for it. Now, that to me is one of the most disgusting things I've ever heard a politician say and in this country. And that deserves resigning over or apologizing publicly to the country. And here she was, Speaker of the House. You know, not that I have anything against Democrats versus Republicans. You know, I'm not like a Republican that hates Democrats or a Democrat that hates Republicans. But to me, I was just revolted by that. But that's exactly what happened here, November 1st. No chance for people in Congress to look at what happened, what was being voted on. Had I not written my column the morning after the draft legislation came out, there wouldn't have been these grandfather clauses. The guys at those treaties told me the column led to the amendments that were passed within a few hours after my column came out, because I was pointing out that people's checks were going to be cut because of this new bill. And then they passed the bill to grandfather certain people. So things have gotten more complicated in the short run. Depending on your age, the software will help. The book will give you a kind of a general idea, and then the columns. Anyway, also just reading my column on a routine basis at PBS NewsHour will help people who we think of democracy is all about.
Well, Professor Lawrence Kotlikoff, what a pleasure having you here today, sir. We'll make sure there are links up to not only the book, but your column, as well as information, this interesting software. Frankly, I'm interested in it, just for my family as well. I want to wish you a happy holidays, happy Hanukkah, and Merry Christmas, sir, and please return to the show.
Same to you and all the listeners. Thank you.
Well, thanks for choosing GoldSeek.com Radio as a trusted business and investing information source. Today's special guest, David Morgan, the Silver Investor. Well, returning to the show, one of the first guests in 2015, the Silver Investor, David Morgan, writes the Morgan Report and runs silver-investor.com. Welcome back, David Morgan.
Chris, great to be with you. Thank you.
Before we get into some of the topicality, and wow, a lot on the plate today in our discussion, pre-interview discussion, just jump right into the silver market. You know, interesting development I read this morning in the silver volume on the Shanghai Futures Exchange, 3 million tons of silver. That's 37% more volume than on the U.S. COMEX exchange. Silver, I'd like your thoughts on what is going on in China with regard to the precious metals. Why have these markets taken off? Why could this be significant for investors?
Well, what's going on is that, you know, China continues to have a huge demand in the physical market for gold and really silver. And it goes unabated. The gold question could be pursued, you know, more in depth, but, you know, there's conjecture that at some point the yuan or renminbi could be gold-backed. But, you know, we've talked about that in the past. As far as silver's concerned, one of my guys, Chris Marchese, has done a few interviews about the Shanghai Exchange, its importance, and why it could at some point in the future if it usurp the COMEX. In other words, the people are tired of the shenanigans going around these paper markets and manipulation and everything else. And because of that, you may see the overall price-setting mechanism be determined out of a different market. You know, the LBMA certainly has been tainted and have changed, you know, silver fix to a new mechanism, gold fix. There's been a lot of things happening kind of behind the scenes that we in the gold silver community are aware of, but I don't think any of us are aware totally, one, of everything, and two, what's the future holds exactly. But the trend is clear, and the trend is metal, real metals going from west to east. East is establishing itself more and more almost on a daily basis as being the go-to place for real inventory, real metal, real settlement price, etc. So that trend will continue, and there could be a day where basically the waning of the Anglo-American Empire influence in the derivatives markets that control the price could be come to an end, could be diminished, could fade away, any of those. And I think that's absolutely that's the trend. And how it unfolds or unravels, is it quickly or slowly, that's to be determined.
You know, last week, one of our top topics du jour, the Russian ruble story, particularly with regard to the gold to ruble ratio, was in a downtrend for several months, and then suddenly it spiked up, almost reminiscent of the Bitcoin drama we saw in 2012. And then gold in terms of rubles soared over 100% in less than about 6 or 7 weeks. And I think it's significant. This next leg in the precious metals, whether it be this year or 5 years from now, we don't know. It could come suddenly. It could be an amazing revaluation. You know, how many people do you think really were anticipating the crude oil meltdown? But, you know, West Texas Intermediate crude had been moving sideways. The fracking industry, strong as could be in the Midwest. And then suddenly, a 50% crash, and there's calls for considerably lower, $20, $30 a barrel on crude oil, where it was just trading at $105. If the ruble can revalue like that, admittedly, it's a BRIC nation, but it's still, you know, one of the larger of the peripheral nations. If that can happen, what's to stop the U.S. dollar in the coming years to experience a similar crisis that very few people, if anybody, sees?
Well, what's to prevent it is the fact that it's, you know, so pervasive. I mean, the dollar is ubiquitous across the world. I mean, it's everywhere and owned by everyone. But you have to look the other side of the coin. The old expression, you know, the bigger they are, the harder they fall. And, you know, without the Fed's ability to monetize the debt or take control or, you know, stop a run on the dollar, which certainly is possible. I'm not rolling this out. I was trying to get both sides of the argument. Is once they lose control, and they can, it would not only make the ruble look like a warm-up, it could be something, you know, equal to or greater than that experience. I want to move forward on this a little bit, Chris, if I might. There's a guy that I became familiar with at the Silver Summit in October. His name is Bo Polny. kind of controversial guy, but he speaks his mind very passionate. He's very sincere. And he was predicting an explosion in the price of gold and sort of this runaway up move by the end of the year. You know what? He was wrong. He was right. And how can I make a statement like that? He was wrong in U.S. dollar. But in Russian ruble terms, that graph looks almost identical to the one that he was projecting. So, besides Chris, that these things do take place. This is the real world. If you're Russian and own the ruble and you own gold, you would have been smiling from face to face. And, Chris, I think that the devaluation was like a 50% one on the ruble, but gold appreciated 100%. So, you know, again, a Russian gold owner is smiling being a gold owner.
President Vladimir Putin was accumulating massive stockpiles in recent years. Clearly, officials were aware that something was going on. I mean, it could be a fortuitous coincidence. I'm losing confidence in coincidences lately. But, you know, I think maybe we could investigate just a bit further this concept of how this could just be the opening salvo. Once again, although it may take a longer time for this to unfold, you know, the U.S. dollar, as you say, ubiquitous. Folks are turning to it. I mean, we've got to be honest, last 7 months have been one of the most spectacular runs in the greenback that we've seen since at least, 2008? But, you know, if you really look back on the monthly chart on the U.S. dollar, you notice on the futures contract there, the USDX, that there's been two other identical rallies that lasted just as long, 6 to 8 months, over the past, let's say, the last 5 or 6 years during this consolidation. And every single time we fell back into the trading range. Now, there's no reason to think that history is going to repeat, but it might rhyme. Do you really believe we're entering a new multi-decade or multi-year-long uptrend in the dollar where everybody's going to fall back in love with U.S. treasuries? I find that a little hard to stomach, but I mean, stranger things have happened.
Well, one, I wouldn't rule it out because, you know, I'm good enough, I guess, to admit that I'm not always right and my views aren't always in line you know, with what's taking place. I mean, the markets can definitely dumbfound the best of us. But I want to address it in two ways. I want to address it fundamentally, and then I want to talk about it technical level. Fundamentally, it's not surprising, Chris, and the reason I say that is looking back at some of the earliest work on the debt bomb and fiat currencies, and that was done by John Exter. And it's the Exter Pyramid. You can Google the Exter Pyramid. I've written about it, several others. I'm certainly not the go-to guy on it. I was maybe one of the few from, you know, the old days, meaning I was through the first bull market that brought it to the attention. But, you know, John Exter is the inventor of it, not me. Nonetheless, what it says is what you expect before a run to gold is a run to the U.S. dollar. So that fits. It fits that paradigm because the idea is that most people that are unawake and unaware and have concern over the stock market, their pension fund, the uncertainty of the markets, the oil price, food prices, you name it, whatever their concern is, they go to safety. And the most perceived safety is, you know, dollar bills in your hand under your mattress. I mean, to be as crude as possible. Now, that is a metaphor, really, for the reality of going to just stuffing money in your savings account or a checking account or both, because most people don't get physical, you know, pieces of paper. But the same idea is clear. It's going to cash. And the only thing that's the next step is what you asked me, is what moves that cash from that position to the next tier of the pyramid, which is the precious metals. And the answer to that is it could be some triggering event. Certainly there's been a move into gold. I mean, you know, as bad as gold has done the last 3 years, if you look at it on a, you know, 10 or, you know, 15 year chart, it really doesn't look that bad. I mean, if you bought it in 2000, 2002, 2003, 2004, 2005, you know, if you bought it in those areas and, you know, put in 10% of your money there and just held it, you're not upset. But if you bought in the last 3 years, you are. So, you know, I just want to give some perspective because I think it's important to put perspective on these things and look at them in context. And if you're looking at gold as a short-term trader, if it doesn't make you a millionaire within, you know, 6 months' time, something's wrong with gold. Well, no, something might be wrong with your time frame or your expectations. Moving back to our point, Chris, look, there's a lot of things that could trigger people to move out of the safety of cash into the precious metals. And I think oil, as you said, is probably one. It's basically, you don't even have to name it being a stock market or the oil market or food prices rising or whatever. Those are individual causes. They could be collective, but it's basically uncertainty in the market. So the certainty of cash becomes uncertain. And when that takes place, regardless of the triggering mechanism, that's when the run to gold starts. And as we both know, the amount of physical gold owned on a global basis is probably less than 1% of the entire global financial system. So to double it to 2% and leave 98% of the financial system alone would take the gold price to an astronomical level. This is the concept I try to really instill in people's thinking, that one, how small the market is, and two, it wouldn't even have to be a panic. It would just have to be a move that people decide, you know what, I need to own some gold. I need to own some silver. And all of a sudden, that consciousness takes hold and it ignites. And all of a sudden, there's a move or run to gold, as I call it. And that could take this, that could blow the doors off of this paper paradigm that's been used to control the price. Because right now, I mean, a lot of people don't talk about this, but I will. You know, as bad as the market is throughout, with the Forex trading and the LIBOR and all this, where there's admitted falsehood and manipulation and it's provable and they pay fines and they admit they're wrong and they're doing it, regardless of what your view on manipulation is, that the price that exists does give the price paid in most cases for the physical metal. So in other words, even though it's manipulated, when you've got, sub $20 silver, you can buy it for that. And that's important to realize. But the other part of the story is that at some point you may not be able to. And that was true at the 2008 crisis. You could buy silver blocks, commercial bars, for the quoted futures price. So let's be clear on that. But you could not buy retail product at that price. You had to pay like $13. So there was a disparity between the metals, quote, paper price for commercial bars versus what the retail market held. They merged and they became basically the futures price. And I warned people about that. A lot of people are telling me, this is it. This is the discrepancy that a lot of you have talked about. And, the real price of silver is 13. Well, the real price of silver is 13 for those that needed to buy 100-ounce bars, 1-ounce, government minted coins, that kind of thing. The point I'm making is simple. That discrepancy could take hold again, or even the commercial bars are at a premium relative to the quoted price. And that discrepancy won't last for long, because what will happen is that the people in the know that might want to make a bunch of money in the futures market that will sell, physical metal now for a much lower price in the future, which is called backwardation. And let's be extreme about it, Chris, so it's very clear. So you could sell metal today for $25 an ounce and buy it 6 months out for $20 an ounce. That's quite a spread, especially when you're using leverage. But they would be unwilling to do so. Why would that happen? It's a locked-in profit. And the reason being is that physical reality doesn't equal the paper paradigm. And if these people that held the physical bars needed it for industry or protection of savings, or wealth protection, they would say, I'm not giving up this metal. We haven't reached that point, but the day of reckoning is coming, and that's the basic outline of the thought process. So if you see a large backwardation like that and it doesn't resolve itself in a few days, week at the most, that is the biggest clue you can get. And by that time, it may be a little late to get on board if you're a big investor. If you're a small investor, then, chances of being able to buy, a box of Eagles or, that type of thing is probably going to exist. But for big players to come in the market, just like in the movie Rollover that I used to show on the speaking circuit, head trader at that New York bank says, bullion, grab what you can get. In other words, there might not be much out there that's even available to buy.
conditions of supply are very tight. Also can be a loss in confidence of the deliverability of the underlying physical metal in the future, where traders just don't accept that the exchange will have the ability or even wherewithal to deliver the metal. I agree that we should be watching, but I also wanted to shift the discussion over to debt deleveraging. You know, this is a component that many folks have missed, and I'd like your thoughts on this $quadrillion, you know, derivatives, and let's say there's roughly somewhere around $300 trillion in notional credit-sensitive derivatives of the inflation deflation. We see this deleveraging, as I think is occurring all over the world, and could increase now that the crude oil contracts are imploding on institutions, not only in the U.S., but Europe, and we see institutions unwinding debt positions. Could that force our central banking officials to make more helicopter drops?
I've never ruled out deflation entirely. In fact, every time I've been asked about hyperinflation, I said it won't happen. And I've explained that because of the debt markets and how they work and how if there was a hint toward hyperinflation, you would see the interest rates go up and that means bond prices go down. So you would have an increase in the cost of money and the risk would be increasing. And because of that, the amount of value in the bond market would be less and less and less as interest rates would higher and higher and higher. So that's point number one. I've never said we'd have hyperinflation. In fact, I'm almost certain that we will not. On the deflation argument, it's the thing that the Fed or the central bankers fear the most because it can become a self-fulfilling prophecy. People expect lower prices. They're not going to spend. The problem is the reality of the situation that we have is you have both. Of course, being an Austrian, I'm not supposed to say that. But, you know, from a physical reality perspective, we do. I mean, college tuition cost for me went up 22% the first year my oldest girl was in college. You know, that is very inflationary, borderline hyperinflationary. Food costs have gone up. Gasoline costs have gone down. Healthcare premiums have gone up. Asset prices of homes have gone down. So you have this sort of mixed bag of asset prices that have decreased. Electronics prices have come down. Healthcare has gone up. So you got up here, down there, up here, down there. And that's, you know, from a price perspective, that's both. You have inflation and deflation. Now, prices are just not really an indicator of if you have inflation or if you don't have inflation.
Jim Rickards did an excellent job outlining this dichotomy, really, between the everyday omoyen who has to pay the bills, we all do, grocery shopping and whatnot, disconcerting signs of inflation in virtually every good and service, whereas on the other hand, an implosion in financial assets around the world that's only being offset by central bank money printing. Underlying theme of inflation against a backdrop of massive government intervention to stem the tide of deleveraging. His thesis, though, I think contradicts what many people are looking for. Ultimately, Rickards says that we will see a wholesale destruction of the entire system itself, whether it be inflationary or deflationary. Does this sound like a viable situation to you, or is it just too extreme?
No, I think, you know, I don't agree with everything of Jim Rickards, but I agree with most of this stuff. And you know, I think he's a very clear thinker in almost all venues, and I think he's right on. I've read his books as well, and I really think he's very clear, he's very precise, he's easy to understand. He brings these issues to before that most people can, you know, understand quite easily. And his books are clearly written. And I do think you're right, or he's right, that this is what we have. So it's sort of, you know, the overworked colloquialism. It's sort of a match waiting for the gasoline. It's sort of just sitting there lit. And we don't know what's going to set it off, but something could. And there's a lot of things that could. So it's basically not so intuitive to most people, but really you want to prepare for both. What you want to prepare for is a possible continuance of the deleveraging, which means you want low debt or no debt. want to owe nothing to anyone, even at these low interest rates. This is, I'm talking on an individual basis, not talking about a corporation that's in debt to sustain a business. So you want to have zero debt if you can, and then you want to have inflation hedges, and then just want to live within your means from that point forward. The reason being is that even if we go into a large inflation or, you know, slash almost hyperinflation, the idea that that will bail you out is a misnomer. Just because it took place in the past, meaning in the, you know, late 70s or 80s, and owning real estate was one of the best things you could do, owning precious metals at the end was probably the best thing you could do, doesn't necessarily mean that it'll repeat this time. In fact, the housing market, even though it's quote-unquote recovered some, was basically a lot of hedge funds that were buying properties for cash. They're buying them at good value. It would take, you know, for example, $75 a square foot to build this unit, and it could buy it for $65 a square foot. That's a pretty sound investment. You can buy it for less than it costs to construct it. That is.
Yeah, not to mention the free money, compliments of the U.S. Federal Reserve, the ECB and the BOJ and the People's Bank of China. You know, you throw out enough free money that's accessible only to said institutions, and sure, we'll buy up your foreclosures, we'll buy up your distressed properties all day long and dump them on your backs in 2015 and 2016.
Precisely, exactly. So that's what we're facing. And so it can go both ways in a way. You know, I mean, I'm not trying to get the Austrians mad at me, but I'm trying to be practical. I'm just very honest from the aspect that I don't rule out deflation entirely. I mean, Mike Maloney and I are close friends. Mike is expected, you know, a really big, you know, deflationary scare before we start getting the kick in of a very large inflation. This oil price situation, I mean, it could continue to deleverage. And, you know, if people get scared, the cash that we talked about earlier in the show, Chris, could continue for quite some time. I mean, really right now from where I sit, subject to change because of all the black swans are out there, we could get an instant light off, as I use the match analogy, at any time. So let's keep that in mind. But that aside, you know, we could go half a year again and see the metals basically drift sideways to slightly higher. And, you know, might get a rally from, you know, current levels of silver up to, say, you know, 22 or 23, which is no big event on a percentage basis. If you're buying, you know, at 17 and, you know, it goes up to that percentage-wise, you know, it's a pretty good return. But it's, you know, I mean, we were in the 30s a few years ago. Gold as well. I mean, you could see gold go from, you know, the 1,200-ish level to, say, you know, 1,500 or something. And, you know, percentage is a pretty nice return. But, you know, 1,500 is a far cry from the 1,900 high that we saw. Anyway, the point being that I think you've got to be mentally prepared above anything for what's ahead and plan accordingly, which means, as I said, you know, low debt, no debt, have savings. And I would split your savings. If you just wanted to be very conservative, think the stock market's too high, I would go, you know, part metal, part cash, and just wait and see. I think that's about the most conservative way to view this market.
Yeah, Jim Rickards is certainly, his analysis complements your thoughts there. He's concerned, though, that virtually no asset class will go unscathed in the end game as it unfolds. Deleveraging takes down potentially the entire global system, that there just won't be many places, if any, to hide. He likes cash. We've heard these thoughts echoed by a couple of deflationists regularly on this show for quite some time. And admittedly, they've done quite well with their U.S. dollar bets. It certainly is the ebb and flow. But to me, it looks like just a temporary bait and switch, if you will, that they're luring people into the wrong markets. Sure, we might see another banner year for U.S. equities as global investment funds continue to pile into the U.S. But we're also seeing some interesting signs that preceded the end of the last U.S. equities bull rally. For instance, the implosion of crude oil coincided with the end of the equities rally. We've also seen the junk bond crash. You might recall we saw that. Well, we're seeing a lot of signs of cracks in that market, trouble on the CRB. I can't imagine, more similarities between the last equities downtrend. And of course, you also see prices in gasoline start to decline. Best case coincidental indicators, economic indicators that the equities rally could be in jeopardy. Do you have any thoughts there and what that might mean for the precious metals?
Well, gold's the most negatively correlated asset to the stock market. The stock market is overvalued by any metric you want to use. The insiders are basically out. There's a huge dichotomy. One of the best indicators you can have is where you have an increasing price market by increasing volume. That's called a huge discrepancy. And that is very, very clear if you look at the basic technicals of the overall stock market. So I think we're set up for a fall in stock prices. Just because everything I said is a truthful fact doesn't mean it's imminent, but it could be. I would definitely, if I were in the general equities market, I'd be looking very carefully at what I own, what the situation is on a case-by-case basis. I would certainly lighten up, a stock position, because I think that there's just too many indicators that are very clear that the equity market could be in trouble. It is in trouble. But, when is that going to manifest in the reality with lower stock prices? I don't know.
Yeah, I think it's well said. I mean, take a look at the Dow closing regularly at all-time, at least nominal highs in its 117-year history, nothing like it. The NASDAQ approaching year 2000 bubble frothiness. Remember that 5,000 point for a brief period of time way back in the year 2000 preceded a three-year downtrend. And of course, the S&P 500, I challenge folks to pull up a monthly chart going back to 1998 to today, and you see a remarkably similar parabolic rise that really, I think, just shadows the intensity of this stratospheric climb in prices. This thing may have another 6 months in it, might have another 2 years in it before we really know. And maybe if you talk to the everyday person, I think they're still gun shy of equities. I think they're nervous because of what happened to their accounts in 2008-2000 due to margin-related losses, and are still just nervous by the thought of U.S. equities. There could be substantially higher to go, maybe 20,000 Dow after this correction passes. Plenty of signs of that, but ultimately, I think your risk to reward somewhat skewed with U.S. equities, and maybe time to start diversifying into undervalued assets. And I can't think of a better undervalued asset, as you point out the metric of silver, $6 under the cost of production. That's the type of, metric you like to hear that indicates that something has to break somewhere. I mean, if producers are producing at a loss and would seem to indicate a real value opportunity in silver. Any other comments today, David Morgan?
Yeah, a couple. If like people, this is a fresh interview for the new year. Thank you, Chris. Just go to the website, silver-investor.com. Take a look at the upcoming event called the Checkerboard Game. We're going to be looking at the metals, but we're actually looking at a bigger picture. This is a situation where we look at the future of money, power, and consciousness. It's not too woo-woo, but it's done by this gentleman named Marshall Thurber, who was instrumental in influencing both Robert Kiyosaki, Rich Dad Poor Dad, and Tony Robbins, probably the best-known personal development guru on the planet. So this Marshall Thurber is somebody that you'll have the opportunity to meet and learn from, because he's the inventor of the checkboard game. And then we're going to move on the rest of the day, Q&A and lectures regarding, what you as an individual can do to be ready for what we see ahead in this global economic structure that we're now seeing and is going to change, like it or not. So please go to my website, check that out. Remember, if you subscribe to the Morgan Report at our Basic Plus service, you are allowed to email me and get a response guaranteed. That's something that not every newsletter writer offers. Certainly, it's more than me. We have a pretty good-sized staff, and we do still believe that some portion of everybody's portfolio should be in physical precious metals, and the mining shares are unbelievably leveraged to any increase in the price of metal. And even if the metals go sideways, Chris, the decreased oil price will help the bottom lines of most of these producing miners.
Now, I think that's just another key takeaway point. You know, we keep pounding the table with regard to a 50% decline or more in West Texas Intermediate crude. That takes this energy-intensive sector, the precious metals mining, the net income of a precious metals mining company. I mean, for instance, the Alpha Stocks newsletter, having folks getting involved with, you know, Delta and several other of the high-flying airlines for some time in anticipation of lower energy prices. We never expected or anticipated 50% decline. But the point is, it worked out well. Well, here you have these share prices, which are obviously starting to respond to lower energy costs. And that translates into improved, I hope, share prices in 2015. The Silver Investor, it's always a pleasure to have you here. We're going to look forward to hearing your thoughts again in 2015.
Chris, thank you.
Hey Chris, this is Robert Ian with ConquerChange.com. A figure-ground relationship is when you have a picture where the foreground is perceived as the background, and the background is perceived as the foreground. Your mind will often battle back and forth at a conscious level, trying to reconcile which image you are actually perceiving. In other words, what is supposedly real. Probably the best example of this demonstration is the image of two faces looking at each other. On one hand, they appear to be two faces, but simultaneously, there also appears to be the outline of a vase between the two faces. Unless you call someone's attention to what they are observing, they will see either the two faces or the vase. They will almost never see both. If you've never experienced this mind game, type figure ground image into Google Images and take a look. This kind of psychological misdirection isn't limited to just pictures on paper. We think in pictures. And because the words we speak, or that others speak to us, create word pictures in our mind, the takeaway messages the media orchestrates for us to believe sometimes take the form of carefully crafted figure-ground relationships, where the foreground is actually the background, and the background is actually the foreground. In other words, it's that ambiguous zone where the lie becomes the truth, and how we come to know what isn't really so. Case in point was Wednesday's Fed announcement by Janet Yellen, whereby the Fed raised interest rates by a much publicized quarter point, the bare minimum, mind you. This was the first time in 7 years the Fed raised interest rates, and in my opinion, the last. This was a token form of financial window dressing to quiet the critics. If you observed any media coverage of the rate hike, not too much emphasis was placed on this quarter point, but they sure were spinning the Fed commentary for 2016, suggesting there would be not one, but four more quarter point rate hikes for next year, all designed to cement in our collective brains that the economy is good and getting better. All designed to cancel out any thoughts to the contrary of any uncontrolled economic weakness. The mere fact that the Fed saw the need to raise rates a quarter point to continue this game of psychological financial warfare tells me they are losing ground faster than expected. Janet Yellen blinked, and this quarter point increase is indisputable evidence. In our figure-ground relationship, what Janet Yellen announced on Wednesday is not the foreground or substance of our image, even though it's what everyone is seeing and talking about. Janet Yellen is just the background. Hidden away on Tuesday, in a MarketWatch article, was an interview with former Fed Chair Ben Bernanke. Just one day ahead of Yellen's much-publicized announcement, Bernanke said the Federal Reserve should consider using negative interest rates to counter the next serious downturn. Bernanke hedged Yellen's announcement. He said, "I think negative rates are something the Fed will and probably should consider if the situation arises." For those of you who missed it, this interview was the real story of the week. It is predictive programming at its best. Uncle Ben has already given permission and cover for negative interest rates. When this supposedly recovering economy goes south once again. Negative interest rates have already been used in Europe. The theory is that if needed in the U.S., negative interest rates will only affect overnight deposits for banks. Bernanke says he's unaware of personal checking accounts in Europe paying negative rates, so he believes ordinary people remain unaffected by such a policy. But if we have another serious downturn, as Bernanke calls it, there's going to be a larger segment of our population that may not need to worry about how negative interest rates impact their checking account, because they may not have a checking account or any money to worry about. And until next time, this is Robert Ian, reminding you to follow us on Twitter @ConquerChange. Thanks, Chris.